So, let's go ahead and get started. Obviously, you both have had me before as a judge, so I'll skip the introduction on that front, but welcome to Judge Adaptation. I'd actually like to start with a story, and a couple of you may have heard spin on this type of story before. But one day, there's a researcher, and this researcher decides that they're going to conduct an experiment. So they put together three volunteers, and they tell these volunteers, I want you to go into this dark, pitch-black cave, and there's this item inside the cave, and I want you to record and explain what that item is, and then talk amongst each other about it. So the people agree, and the volunteers then go in this cave. And this cave is so dark that they can't see anything that's in that cave at all. So what's actually in this cave? Is an elephant. But they have no idea that an elephant's in the cave. So each of them goes in the cave, and they all go in from different angles. So one person's over here, and since they can't see anything, they start sort of feeling around. One person over here, and one person over here. So this person over here at the tail is feeling the tail and thinks, oh, there's a rope in this cave. This person over here is feeling the leg of the elephant and says, hey, there's a tree trunk in the cave. And then this person over here who's feeling the elephant's ear thinks, seems like there's a piece of leather in the cave. So they all sort of record that and they think, hey, maybe that's the item that was in the cave that the researcher is looking for. So they do that. And they all come back and they talk to the researcher and they start talking about what they saw. Oh, there's a rope in the cave. Second person says, what? There wasn't a rope. There was a tree trunk. What are you talking about? This person's like, you both are wrong. It was a piece of leather. And finally, they start arguing and fighting amongst each other about what's in the cave. And the researcher stops them and says, you're all right. You're right. What you felt like a piece of rope. You felt something that felt like a tree trunk, and you felt something that felt like a piece of leather. You are all correct. Your experience, what you felt, is all true. And your small piece was part of a much larger whole. And that's the approach that I want us to think about when we think about judge adaptation, which is this person might come into the activity from a very unique perspective and have a particular view of debate that's informed by their experiences and things. They might see debate in a certain way, like communication-oriented. This person might come in with a policy background. This person might come in with a very different experience about how they view it. But every person's experience and every part of the whole that they've experienced is incredibly valid and is important. And where we get into trouble is when we start to assume that our perspective or our experience is somehow better or more valid than somebody else's. So as a critic, it's recognizing where they come from, how they view the activity, and how their perspective is true and is part of a larger whole. And somebody, even with the most experience ever, who's done tons of judging, is never going to have the whole thing, the whole part of the debate. They're still coming from a unique perspective that's valuable, that's important, and that's part of the activity. So that's important as we start to think about judge adaptation. So for this lecture, and feel free to jump in if you have any questions or comments as well throughout the lecture, but I've structured it first to talk about identifying judges and that sort of pre-round prep stage, second to talk about in-round strategies that you can do, third to have a discussion about panels and what to do when you have a mix of different judge types on panels, and then opening up the final part of this lecture for questions and comments as well. So first, when I talk about judge adaptation, what I fundamentally mean is altering and enhancing the strategy that you do as a debater based on the judge or the judges you have in the name of both inclusion for the judge and for competitive success. So it's not necessarily changing who you are, what you debate, or what you believe in, but in most instances, it's sort of changing how you do debate. and how you do the debate considering that judge in mind. And as part of that first process of identifying judges, there are a lot of different things that you can do. The biggest thing, and this is with a caveat, is reading judging philosophies. Most tournaments, either on websites such as forensicstournament.net, again, it's forensicstournament.net, as well as parleytournament.com, if the tournament's hosted through that service, provide a whole link and page about judge philosophies. So in Forensics Tournament, if you go to the tournament that you're attending, there's a judge philosophy tab under that. On Parley Tournament, if you go to your tournament, there's usually an entire judge philosophy field. So that's a thing that's very helpful as well, and many tournaments send out judging philosophies ahead of time. So using that is valuable, because judging philosophies give you a sense, the best sense, of a judge that you might not have had. Tells you about their experience and how they view the activity. But judging philosophies are also limited. They only tell a part of the story. There are some people that believe that judge philosophies are completely lies and aren't valid. And there are other people that think that judge philosophies are the be-all, end-all, and the things that matter the most. And I tend to believe that the truth lies somewhere in between. Judge philosophies are useful because they are judges articulating how they believe they view debate. And that's an important distinction, because there might be judges that think they view or evaluate debate in a certain way and have a formula for doing that, but then you look at their actual decisions and they might be really, really different from them. So self-diagnosis has its limits. It's great to figure out if they like or dislike certain types of arguments, but there are limits in terms of them really saying how they view the activity versus their actual decisions, which is part of why watching judges and the decisions they make is really important. One of my debaters types word for word the reason for decision that he gets after the round, and that's one technique that works. You can also, some squads do wikis and other things for certain judges where they sort of take notes on what they saw in the round, how the judge voted, how they looked at the debate. You can also talk to your teammates and talk to coaches who might have had experiences with certain judges on how they judge the round. And you can track those things throughout the year. Like, you can put together a grid with like your win-loss records in front of certain judges and figure out which ones are most likely to help you. Remember, too, that even if you're using services to find a judge philosophy, they might not have one up for that particular tournament. But especially if this is an experienced judge, you could potentially dig back and find philosophies from other tournaments that they were at. So things like Google searches and figuring out maybe what tournaments that judge or that affiliated team might have gone to can be a way to do that as well. Remember as well that it's really a marathon, not a sprint, in terms of judges. You're going to have a lot of the same types of judges at multiple tournaments. And maybe at the first two you don't recognize them, but when you see them more and more, you start to realize what they're like. So putting that together and taking notes in case you have that judge again later is important. And especially if you're starting to gear up for your end of year tournaments and are potentially getting ready for nationals, that becomes really important as you're assembling like your preps and your strikes as well. Because you've had the chance to get notes and figure out these judges and sort of do that experience too. What's up?
What's a prep and a strike?
Oh yeah, so some tournaments offer preferences, which is basically you rank judges that you liked more than other judges, and there's like a whole sheet you fill out and turn in for your team. And the idea is that there are different systems depending on the tournament, and they've experimented with different ones, but say there's a judge that you really like and another team likes that same judge, they'll try to put you with that judge. So like, they try to put teams with similarly ranked judges. So if a judge is kind of an iffy, not very high preference, they'll put that judge with two debaters who have similar views on that judge. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, strikes, some tournaments only offer strikes and don't do preps. Some tournaments do both. A strike is when, and you have a limited number of them, it prevents you from ever having that judge. So if you're like, this judge is bad, I don't want this judge, no way, you can use a strike, and that judge will not judge you for the entirety of the tournament. And remember as well that you can also ask judges before the round starts, what are your preferences and views about debate, or something like that. And most judges love to give their little spiel about how they view the activity and all that stuff, and are just sort of waiting for the magic word on, you know, how do you look at debate? Well, and then they like to go to town on that. So when you do get the chance to see judging philosophies before the round starts, if you have a certain judge and you're trying to figure that out, some of the things you can look at is like their experience and competition and coaching, schools they might come from, things like how they view the activity. So fundamentally, like, what is a good debate for them? What does that look like? What they think about certain types of arguments. So if you really want to run a critique in a round, but you're not sure how the judge evaluates the critique or if they like it or not, you can look to that in the philosophy. And then also what they think about the activity, about the direction it's going, what they like and don't, and that gives you a sense of their argument preference as well. But an important consideration about the affiliation and things from judges is that you might see a judge from a certain school, and you're like, this is a great school, they have a great program, they came from a great place, they're really successful. Or you might have somebody who was like, this person was a national champion, they were really great at debate. And then they come back as a judge, and maybe you're not the best judge. Their experience as a competitor does not necessarily inform the type of judge they are. And there are some judges who were great nationally, didn't end up being that great of judges. But on the other side of the coin, as an example, from what I gather and what I know, one of the coaches at Utah, Jason Jordan, did no competition in speech and debate, and is now a coach, and is one of the best critics in the activity. He's very fair, he's really knowledgeable, he has a great sense of the activity, and is really great at it, and is a really great critic to have. But if you're going off of competitive experience, you might not have put him as a high prep because of that. So that's something to think about. And remember, especially, if you have a judge who identifies themselves as a first year out, which means that it's their first year that they're done competing and they're now judging and coaching, be really careful with those judges, because they're really new to judging most of the time. They still are thinking like a competitor rather than a judge, and they haven't really gotten much experience yet thinking the way a judge might and having to figure out things that judges might have to do. But when we're thinking about judge adaptation, the sort of three areas and types of judges you can start thinking about are these. I'm reluctant to sort of categorize them like this, but I do think it's somewhat useful in terms of broad categories. Like, actual judges have a lot more nuances than them. They sort of cross different ways with a lot of these and have intersections and have their own individual preferences. But as a general way of thinking about it, lay-oriented judges are ones that typically don't have much experience with the activity at all. They could be just hired by a tournament to help cover entries. For example, tournaments like Pacific might just hire some grad students who don't have much experience in debate to judge some rounds because we really need judges. Or it could be the significant other of a debater or a coach. That sometimes happens. But they don't have much experience with the activity. But that doesn't mean that they're not intelligent or they don't know what good debate is and what good debaters are like. They oftentimes look to things like good public speaking skills, like common sense. And if you're being perceived as being confident and smart and like you're the best debate team in the room. And then communication-oriented judges, or COM, are typically ones that have sort of master's or education background that's related to communication. So a lot of times these are judges that might be certain types of junior or community colleges, but not always. It can be a variety. But many of these judges view the activity as very public speaking based, that having good speaking skills and communication is really important, and that things like speed aren't good in the activity. So that might be how they approach the activity as well. But that can also be different depending on the critic. And then the more policy and technical oriented judges are ones that usually have like a more nationally competitive background, and they really sort of like the technical kind of flow centric debate. So that's sort of the broad categories. But fundamentally, regardless of the judge that you have going in, it's asking yourself, what is my plan of attack? And what do I need to do to win the judge or the panel? And what can I do to ultimately win? Because as is the case with the arguments you make, having a vision of how to win the round is very important. So that sort of goes to the things that you can do in the round as well. So a lot of what we've been doing at the camp is technical things and those types of tweaks to help you in front of a lot of the more technical and policy-oriented critics. Yeah?
What would you say is the distribution of judges?
So that'll depend a bit on the tournament. One of the interesting things this year is at Nationals, because it's going to be in likely in Southern California, there'll be a lot of community and junior colleges and a lot of communication-oriented judges. So that'll be more than usual, but it sort of depends on what tournament you're going to. For example, do you know what tournaments you might be going to this year? Or what region are you from? Where are you going to school?
Here.
Oh, okay. In that case, you'll probably be going to ones like Lewis and Clark and Western and Pacific University in Forest Grove alternate, but a lot of ones that are in the Northwest. Those tend to have a higher number of policy-oriented judges, and probably usually a few communication-oriented judges on the side who are hired and sort of joined. So you might have maybe 10 or 11 policy judges and then two or three communication judges. So that would be that distribution. And then at Nationals, it can be really varied. Like a lot of those tournaments might have, 40 or 50 policy judges and then 20 or 30 communication judges and maybe 5 to 10 lay judges, sort of depending. But you can also, as you sort of get to know the names and things too, sort of see that at tournaments as well. But that's generally what I think things would look like regionally for you all. But there's different judges have different views, but a lot of what I'm sort of thinking about is adapting to lay and more calm-oriented judges, because a lot of what we've done at the camp is appealing and adapting to the more technical style of the game. So one of the most important things to remember is that 99% of the time, you are not going to change the judge's view of the activity or of certain arguments. You're already fighting against the other team in order to win the ballot, and it becomes an uphill battle if you decide that you want to change the judge's view of the activity too. For example, you might have a judge that really doesn't like critical debate, and you decide, I have this awesome K. It's such a great argument. It is so great that it's going to convince the judge, and they're suddenly going to love the K. And that doesn't happen. Instead of trying to change how the judge views debate in order to win, it's better to debate within their view of the activity in order to win. So sort of select your arguments and things knowing what the judge likes and doesn't like. And one of the nice things too is that when you adapt to more communication or lay-oriented judges, you can avoid a lot of jargon. Like instead of saying subpoint A is the uniqueness, number one, blah, 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 you could say, in the status quo, the economy is very low right now. Or instead of link or solvency, you could say, our plan is able to address this issue by doing this or that. So you can still make the same types of points, but avoid using jargon in order to do so. And to that end, still flowing the same way during prep helps out a lot. Like, you can still flow things as uniqueness and links, but then once you give the speech, you can have that different, because you're still making the same types of arguments. An advantage is still an advantage. It is worth making, but you can sort of phrase it differently depending on the judge that you have. So some other techniques for an adaptation, especially for lay and calm judges, is standing up. A lot of times, competitors will ask judges, who are more calm or lay, do you mind if I sit down or do I have to stand up? And that's not strategic. It's better to just stand up and do that rather than asking, because it makes it seem like you're adapting to them or you have to do something that you don't want to do, that sort of thing. Unless you have health problems or concerns that affect your ability to stand up. I had low blood pressure as a competitor, so I sometimes, if I was having some trouble, asked to sit down. But if you can, it's generally good to do it, and it can help you in your confidence in speaking as well. Gesturing and eye contact help out a lot too. So I know that Western is partly oriented rather than IEs, but if you're at a tournament that offers individual events and you watch them, that can help out a lot, especially platform speeches like persuasion and informative. You can also, if you have public speaking classes, you can take those as well as electives, but think about ways that you could improve as a public speaker and develop those skills that are sort of outside of debate. Because once you do that, those can really help you once you go into debate in those types of rounds. And oftentimes, the coaching and background that debate has, or partly has, doesn't necessarily lend itself to that style. Like, there are a lot of debaters who are great at being technical in that, but get really nervous or not very good at the public speaking style. So things like analogies and examples are really great too. There was a round where I was reading on the judge's philosophy. They said speed kills, and they were referring to speaking quickly and all that. And the topic was about Yemen, and we were neg. So the affirmative was going to send military forces to Yemen and do all that. And we on the negative were reading the status quo will solve that, and if you're really quick and you do the plan, that's only going to create more violence and chaos. So in my rebuttal, I said to the judge, hey, I know your philosophy says speed kills, but speed kills in this context too. The speed that the plan would go and create this conflict would be bad and lead to more violence. So it's better to wait and prefer us on the negative. So things like analogies, examples, and ways to wrap up and explain it can help as well. And additionally, at the end of the round, oftentimes more lay or calm judges don't necessarily like to give decisions or would rather have their ballot turned in, if it's a paper ballot, before they give a decision. And that's okay. Don't try to force them to give their decision or explain how they voted or all that. Because if you do that, it just forces them to hastily make a decision, or it makes them dislike you and are stressed out about that. It only creates a greater problem. And to that end as well, the idea of lighting up critics or just arguing with them and going to town with them about their decision being wrong is never a good idea. What's up?
So lighting up means arguing with the judge?
Mm-hmm.
That's a thing?
Surprisingly.
Okay.
But I guess maybe not surprisingly with how argumentative and contentious this activity lends itself to be among folks. But there are people where they believe that they made the right decision and they got robbed by a judge, and they get mad and they decide to argue with them. It is. It's scary. It's scary and uncomfortable to the judge and the other team, and it doesn't do anything. The decision's already made, and it just makes the judge dislike you. In the event that you have them again, you're already fighting an uphill battle with them. It's just not smart. So, if you're negative and you have like a more communication or lay judge, reading a dissad or two on the negative, good, but a lot of player comm judges really like case debate. They like it when you engage in the app and answer it and make a lot of arguments, and because they like that type of clash. So that's something to think about as well, is how do you answer case and answer that? And if you have a lot of arguments, that can help too. But this sort of goes to my next point, which is that good debate is surprisingly similar, regardless of the type of judge that you have. A lot of the qualities about what makes debate good, like making good arguments that you choose, that having good confidence, that evaluating impacts and closing the debate, they affect every single judge. But some judges have that more something that they think about than other judges. Remember as well that sort of as I've talked about in rebuttals, your ability to control the debate, frame the impacts, and explain why you've won the round, like the judge should prefer this and they should evaluate this impact over this impact, helps to control the judge regardless of the type of judge you have. A lot of people think that they've won a round, but they make a really messy round. They don't do much impact work or anything at all. And then they get mad because the judge made a decision that they don't agree with. But the simpler you make the round, the clearer you make it to the judge, the better. By slamming doors and opportunities for the other team to win, you're not only doing that, but you're helping the judge sort of hone where their decision is. You make that more predictable for them as well. So remember that there are debaters that will either succeed or will hold themselves back from being able to succeed. Doing what you need to be able to do to win is really important. It's like those debaters who get mad and argue at judges that don't like their decision. That's silly because they're not doing what they can to adapt and support the judges. And the best, most nationally competitive debaters are the ones that do adapt. There's a great story. Shannon Valvita is a coach at Mount Hood Community College, and she considers herself communication oriented. She wants people to adapt to her and not speak too quickly and not be too technical. And Southern Illinois last year, the team that won the national tournament, one of them, did adapt to her and debated in a way that she was comfortable with and she was okay with. And when Southern Illinois won the national championship last year, she gave them a hug because she felt like they did what they needed to do to win these policy-oriented technical debaters, but also the communication-oriented debaters as well. They fired on all cylinders, and she felt like they deserved it, not because they appealed to a particular part of the debate community, but that they appealed to everybody and worked with people like her as well. So I want to talk about panels. So once you get to out rounds and you start having multiple judges to make decisions, you might have a mix, and that's where things start to get interesting. You might have two policy-oriented judges, you might have a more lay or comm-oriented judge. Especially with the ratio of judges in Northwest tournaments, that tends to be pretty common. And so the question becomes, what do I do, and how do I debate with this type of panel? And one of the biggest things you can do first is flip affirmative. When you have to adapt, it's generally much better to speak affirmative because you get to speak last, first of all, but also because typically adaptation and more calm and lay-oriented judges are the ones that are the less enthused by certain types of negative arguments. Maybe they don't like counterclaims. Maybe they don't like critiques. Maybe they're not a big fan of topicality. Those are all things that hurt negative teams and take away tools that they could use. So to that end, it's strategic to be affirmative because you'll probably have some advantages and you'll have the case, and that's a good way to do that. And that affects your argument selection too. Think about arguments and points that all of them are okay with. If you have two judges that like the critique and one that doesn't, don't run a critique, run some disadvantages that everybody's okay with. And to that end as well, there's the idea of punting critics. This is silly, and this is never something that you all should do. The logic of punting critics, so let's say you have two quick policy-oriented judges and one lay judge. Some people think, hey, if I just go really fast and lose this lay judge, I can just win the two policy judges, I can get a 2-1 decision, and I can win the round. But that's a bad decision for a lot of reasons. When you go in and make that type of decision, you've already lost one judge, which means that the other team only has to win one judge in order to win the round. So they just need one of two as it is. What's up?
So in that scenario, would you just go slower and worry about the policy people? Are policy-oriented judges more likely to understand the technique? So they're going to be like more okay with you changing to, oh, like they're going slower because this person's here?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's exactly it. Policy-oriented judges, most of the time, will be frustrated if it feels like you're punting a judge. And speaking quickly and ignoring them and silencing their voice and perspective, shutting them out of the debate. And that makes them less inclined to want to vote for you anyway. And it puts you at a disadvantage. And one of the biggest things about that as well is that you might think that you could easily win the other judges, but maybe it turns out that you probably didn't because of how you debated. What I would advise is maybe going a little faster than you would in, like, if you only had that communication judge, but not so fast that they lose track of it. That they know that you have some work to do to get to the other two judges as well. And they're all sort of aware of that, and that they appreciate you working to get all three of them. Remember that word economy is important too. A lot of people go through a sequence of, they go through one of two paths. Path number one is, I learn debate, I get the basics down, I'm speaking slowly, I'm understanding, I'm getting more and more arguments, I'm getting more and more ideas, and whoa, I can't fit all these ideas into a speech at a conversational rate. So they start speaking faster and faster in order to accommodate the more and more arguments and ideas they have, so they can fit them in their speech time. The other and much worse track is competitors who think, I want to get really fast really quickly, because if I get fast, then I get good at debate. And then they get fast before they figure out the right types of arguments to make or train themselves to think about debate well. And then they speak really quick, but they make a ton of verbal fillers and they don't make good arguments and they don't debate well. So remember that if you speak slowly, you can still have really good word economy. You can still make a lot of arguments in a little amount of time. And sometimes, even if you speak slowly, you can make a lot of arguments and cover a lot of ground. But speaking more slowly forces you to pick and choose certain argument types, and it helps you to decide what's really important. Because at worst, if you give a slower PMC, that just means that the MG might have more arguments than they can use. Like, if you couldn't read a certain uniqueness argument on the economy being low, maybe they have another argument that they can use later. But it never hurts to give a PMC that's slower and more inclusive of everybody, because it's the PMC as well, and it doesn't have to be set up as intricately and with as many arguments as some other speeches might be. That it already shows that judge that you care about them and that you care about the entire panel. And it sets the pace for the rest of the round too. And sort of that goes to that point that you were mentioning as well, Barry, that if you seem like you're ignoring a critic or punting them or just going for the other critics, that'll irritate them. They won't like that you've done that to them. So remember that adaptation and thinking about different judges can be a really big benefit. One of the strategies that helps a lot of times at nationals is maybe you have a good judge that's more communication oriented or not very fast, and you make them a high preference for the round, or you don't strike them from the tournament because you think they could be really good for you, they could help you out. And one of the great things too, if you have like a really fast-paced, nationally competitive technical team and a communication judge or a communication or lay-oriented panel, is that suddenly these fast teams have to slow down in order to win the round. They get out of their element, and oftentimes they haven't trained themselves in public speaking skills and the ability to be confident, and that lets you have a chance to shine when they're out of their element. You can turn these critics who might be frustrating to some into a strength for you. So sort of some final thoughts before I open up for any questions and additional thoughts you all might have is that one of the really disturbing pieces of data that was released a couple years ago found that, sort of as we're talking about preferences and strikes that you can submit before tournaments, that a judge that was unknown to a competitor was sort of used for analysis. And what they found was that an unknown judge that was male, had a male name, was more likely to be a higher pref and less likely to be a strike than an unknown judge with a female. And that's a problem. It's also a problem with a lack of diversity in judging and judging panels and that, and the amount of judges in the activity that are of color or women or other groups, that's an issue. So as you start to think about tournaments that have strikes and preferences, remember that issue is very important. I think that representation of a variety of perspectives and points, and having more diversity in the judges that you choose is a really good thing. And oftentimes, unfortunately, this community can have problems and be sexist and think, oh, hey, males are better judges, which is not true in the slightest. So that's something to be very concerned and considerate of. For example, y'all's coach, Kristen Stevens, is an excellent coach. She's a great judge, and she's great to have. And that's a perfect example of that type of issue happening. Yeah?
Does that same distribution happen as normal debaters, or is it just debaters not making it to the higher levels?
I think it tends to happen at the higher levels because most of the less nationally competitive tournaments don't have preferences and strikes. That's usually more common at a lot of the more competitive ones. A lot of the ones that you all will be at in the Northwest will have preference and strikes though. So that's something to be thinking about, or maybe just strikes. But rather than, I think one of the best things to think about too is that the best judges are usually the ones that are the most predictable. So you might have a judge that might dislike certain arguments or force you to adapt in a certain way, but if you know how to win their ballot and get them to vote for you, that helps you a lot more than a judge who sort of is all over the map and doesn't seem like they give consistently good decisions. Like, they say they have a view of debate in a certain way, and then they completely disregard it when they judge the next one. So that's something to think about too. So sort of going through that discussion about the issues facing the community, being open to a variety of different views and perspectives in the debate is really important because different people come from different experiences and walks of life and have different views of the activity and what they like and what it should be or shouldn't be. But being open to that is really important. So, you know, sort of being, knowing that we're all part of that elephant, we all sort of walk in with a different perspective and view and experience that is all valid and is all equally valid with each other, and helping that is really important. One of the things that I've always believed is that the best debaters are the ones that exhibit the most empathy. The reason I think that is because some of the best debaters aren't the ones that are the most combative and trying to come up with answers and arguments and how to beat the other person. They're the ones who, when they hear an argument and the point, they do their best to understand it and like really to put themselves in that argument. And then once they do that, they start to pick apart the problems of that argument. It's like they hear a criticism, and it's not immediately, what are my answers? It's, what is this criticism saying? Where are they coming from? What is this argument saying? What are the points of that argument? And then after that, they start thinking about how to answer it once they understand it. The same way that they understand different judges, where they came from, and how they view the activity too, which affects the way that they do debate. So knowing that everybody is valid and has a different point of view, I think is really important. So do y'all have other questions or comments at this point?
Yeah, I mean, we didn't talk really much about arguments here, but what would you say is the spread of judges that like critiques versus don't?
Sure. So in terms of arguments, that really does depend on the type of judge. And like they might like certain arguments over others. What I would say is that lay judges aren't good for critiques because they sort of, it's easy for them to get lost in that and to not understand why we're debating about capitalism if it's a topic about something that might not be directly related to capitalism. That's an example. Another thing is that among communication, it's more split. I would say that about 1 in 3 are okay with it. And then your 2 of 3 might be not a fan but willing to hear it. And then you might have a 3rd that hates it. And there are also policy-oriented judges. Not every single one of them will like the K. There are certain ones that have that experience. For example, Phil Sharp from Reno is not a fan of hearing the critique, even though he's comfortable with a lot of fast-paced and technical debate. And so another thing to think about is topicality. different judges have different thresholds on topicality, which means they're more likely to vote on it, or they're more willing to than some. If they say, like, I have a higher threshold on topicality than most, that means it'll take a lot more to win topicality in front of them, which means you might be less likely to run that argument. Other things that they might say are, I don't like dehumanization impacts, or I don't like extinction impacts, in which case you don't have to read those. You don't have to impact down to extinction or read those types of arguments. See, some other possibilities, they might not like certain types of counterplans, so if you're the NAG, you don't read those types of counterplans. A lot of it is just sort of figuring out what their individual preferences are, because their philosophies will usually say certain things about that. If you want, as an example, I could pull up a philosophy and show if y'all would like.
That would be nice.
Okay, sure.
Also, what about politics? Because obviously, you know, that's chill to, you know, change what arguments you're using, but it seems
right.
Like most of the debate community is fairly socialist, extraordinarily liberal. You know, is it okay to say things, or rather, is it strategic to say things that aren't socialist or liberal?
It's a good question. So, by the way, so this is Forensics Tournament. The view I have of it is that it falls into one of two camps. There might be judges that are very liberal and sort of socialist in their views, but also are more than happy to hear certain types of conservative arguments. So if you read politics about why, like, Jeb Bush is good.
I'm talking more like capitalism good.
Oh,
I'm not like, oh yeah, let's kick out all the Mexicans, but I'm like,
sure,
reasonable.
Sure. I think that even though judges can be liberal, they oftentimes like to hear the other side, and they're willing to consider points that are on the right.
But will they vote on it even if it attaches that to them?
Because a lot of those judges try to keep their own views and personal biases out. Like, what's that?
Tabula rasa.
That tabula rasa, the I'm a clean slate when I go into the round, is a view some judges try to do. But it's like a, if you win that building secure borders is good and is best for the world, and you win that argument on the flow, a lot of critics will vote on it if they're okay with that. There are also some critics, though, I would say probably 70% of critics are fine with that strategy. About 30% might be less inclined or willing to vote on that because they just think, oh, it's not true, that doesn't go with my beliefs, I don't feel comfortable with this. So that's sort of that spread. Most would be totally okay with you sort of reading cap good or going against that, but some, and they usually indicate it on their philosophies, would not be as inclined. So, does that answer your question?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm just, to be really frank, I was just thinking that you're also a judge, so that you might be, you know, saying something that reflects how you would hope you judge debate versus how debate is actually judged or versus your actual experience of how debate is being judged.
Maybe
sure. Just getting totally meta, but I think I can just take your words for this one.
Well, I mean, everybody, including myself, does have biases and they come in with different views and things. And you know, I have biases in terms of what I think judges are like or how I think they view debate. And, you know, I've tried to do my best to make that be informed by my experiences and what I've seen and work and doesn't and not work. But that's true, too. Like, everything, and that's true of any lecture and anything that anybody says, really, that critical thinking and, you know, maybe there are limits and problems with that is something to consider. So I think always having that critical eye is a very good thing. But, so this is Forensics Tournament. So what you can do is go to tournaments. So for example, they'll post the tournament soon of like ones that you all might be going to. So for instance, the Happy Memorial is an upcoming one at Bloomfield College that you all likely would be going to, depending on your schedules. I want to go to one from previous years. Let's see. Some of these are high school. So Mile High is a big tournament each year. It's probably the biggest one before Nationals. So if we went to that, you can see the schools that are entered in. You can see the debate teams that are entered in. And you can see the debate judges. All these fine folks. That's sort of the list of judges. And then you can see the judge philosophy book. And here, for example, Dean accounts. So there's her experience. Here's where she stands on that. So if you're not sure about critiques or how she thinks about those, hey, they're great on both F and A. And she's also explaining certain things that she likes within the critique. So that's an example. So different ones have different styles of writing their philosophies. Some like to write novellas. So like, they might have different parts about different types of arguments, or where they stand on the counterplan versus the take, that sort of thing. So as another example, HarleyTournament.com. If things like pairings are from Harley Tournament, that can be, you can use this site to find philosophies. So for example, you could get to judging philosophies from there. And then you have that. And then that's also where they would post pairings. So those are some of the resources you can use to get philosophies. And the way prefs and strikes usually work is before the tournament starts, typically your coaches will be sent like Excel sheets that lists all the judges, and then you can, from that, indicate which ones you're striking or you're prepping and all that. Especially if you're new to debate and you haven't been in this circuit that much, a lot of times coaches, depending on the team, will do most of that work for you or let you know most things. But as you do it more and more, you can develop more of a sense yourself of what critics you like and don't, and sort of influence that as well. Do you have other questions or things about adaptation?
I mean, I guess while we're here, this is like not really on topic, but just as a, like, the root of your theory of debate personally for you.
Sure.
When you make an argument, do you think you have to believe in it?
I think you have to believe that that argument should be heard. I don't think you should believe in that argument for its own sake, but if you think that that argument is important about, for example, even a lot of really terrible, racist, offensive arguments or points, they're bad. And debate and putting those out there and saying it is an opportunity for that to be interrogated. I think that the moment that we say that certain things are not up for debate or can't be debated or talked about is when we risk sliding into dogma of, oh, well, I just heard that I can't talk about this or can't say this or that this is good or bad. And it avoids the question of why that's good or bad. So I think that arguments that you don't believe that you put out there, like, it's important and it's risky, and a lot of times those types of arguments are not good and they carry consequences if you put them out there. But to put an idea, an argument out that you don't believe, but to just put it out can still be valuable. Does that make sense?
Kind of, yeah, but it sounds like you're advocating putting out racist arguments so people can explain why racist arguments are bad.
What I think is that I don't want people to do that. I don't think that putting racist arguments out is good for the community or is a good strategic choice or it's good for a variety of reasons. Like, But I also don't think that those types of things should be censored or avoided if that's something that people decide for some reason they want to do. Because then that helps show them why they're wrong. Like, we come in assuming and knowing that it's bad because we get that. But then if we sort of lose track and we start to forget why that's the case, then we just sort of believe that it's bad based on hearsay, and we don't really go through that process of critical thinking that helps us remember why it was bad. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Thank you.
Yeah, it's like the distinction is racism is bad because we've developed a historical understanding of it and the way that it's oppressive and bad and terrible, and we've developed that, and that informs us who we are, versus racism is bad because they told me it was bad. Like, that's what, with some things, I fear we might slide into if we don't open up the space to remember and think critically about why those types of things are bad. So I do think putting arguments out there that you don't necessarily believe in sometimes has to happen. Sometimes you're not on the side of the debate that works for you, and sometimes trying to change the round so it fits within that works. But debate can be an opportunity to realize why you might hold that view. And there aren't going to be situations where you have to debate in a racist or defensive or a bad way in the slightest. Well, the vast majority of topics, there might be a couple of exceptions, but there's options for creativity and still being able to hold what you believe in. And if there's not, at the very least, you're creating an opportunity to make a case or show why a certain thing might be good or not. Yeah, do you have any other questions or things for me? Just a couple of minutes before the next lecture starts. I want to make sure there's time for that. Otherwise, I'll have the notes and my PowerPoint uploaded if y'all need those. And I'll have that for the camp as well. But, yeah.
Ben, where are you sending your...
What's up?
Where are you sending the, like, I have, like, a Prezi thing that I should put on, too. Are you sending it, is there, like, a BDC Dropbox still?
There should be, and there's that, and there's that Facebook group as well. I think I was going to talk with Ryan Reed because he's been setting up a lot of the Dropbox stuff, or how else it's getting uploaded. But, yeah, I was going to do that. Otherwise, I just used Google Slides, and I got to this from being logged in on that.
Okay. I just wondered if there was somewhere I could put my stuff or not.
Oh, yeah. There should be.
There should be. I'll ask around. Well, because I'm on Facebook, too, so I've been like, I need the schedule. I was, like, hoping that it didn't change.
Oh, yeah. I'm just going to pack up my laptop, and then I can get that.
Thank you so
much. Thanks, Ben.
Yeah, no problem.